Good morning. Welcome to Grove Park. We're so glad to see each of you this morning. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we'd ask you to fill out a visitor card located on the pew rack in front of you and place it in our offering plates. If you're watching online for the first time, we welcome you. Please send us a note, office@groveparkchurch.com, that we can learn some more about you and share some more about us. In way of announcements this morning, there are a multitude of announcements. One, at the conclusion of service today, we will be setting up in the gym for the Baptist on Mission regional rally, which will be held here on Tuesday. If you are able-bodied, and I'll use that in the broadest definition possible, we can use your help in setting up today. And so, at the conclusion of service, if you would just go to the gym for that. Due to illness, there will be no family hour tonight. We will have our quarterly church conference this evening at 6 o'clock. The groups that will be reporting are Properties, Children's, Community Missions, Trustees, and Personnel. So we hope that you will be here for that. The Baptist on Mission meal and rally is on Tuesday. If you have not signed up to assist in that, please do so today. If you have not signed up to bring a dessert, please do so today. You say, well, Mark, I have so many things to do on Tuesday. Great. You have just volunteered to go through the pews of Grove Park at the conclusion of service today and get all of everyone's spare bulletins. If you are sitting in a particular section, look around and get the bulletins out. You know, I think we leave our bulletins in place so that we have an archaeological record years later about what I preached. Don't leave any archaeological evidence behind today, all right? And then don't just throw it away, put it in the recycling bin in the hall, all right? So if you would do that, we would be very grateful. Ladies Craft Day for SIA is coming up on February 29th. It's a once every 4 years opportunity. Think on that one. All right. February 29th. All right. So, if you have not signed up for that, please do so. We are continuing to collect, small toys and toothpaste for, Hope boxes. And one other note, there is no Bible study this week because of the Baptist on Missions rally. There is going to be a book club on Thursday, though, so continue on with that. And final note, the Get to Know You dinner is at 6:30 on Saturday. That is for folks who have come and have been visiting with us or recently joined our fellowship, and just for them, for those who don't know their way around, just to show them a little bit and ask, give folks the opportunity to ask some questions that they may have, you know, wanted to ask, like, how do you get to the baptistry, or things like that. And so we sent those invitations out this past week, and hope to begin hearing from those folks soon, if not already. You say, well, I'd like to get to know these folks. Well, then, beloved, take them to lunch today. That's how you get to know them. Or take them, or just, you know, say, I'll go invite, I'd like to take you to coffee. I don't know, I don't like to go for coffee, but you can say, I'd like to go for coffee later on. All right? Get to know them. Stick a hand out. Say, welcome. Because isn't that what everybody wants? Somebody to say welcome to them. To say you're part of us, you're at home. Isn't that what God does for us in extending out his hand of mercy and grace to us? Not just on special occasion days, but every day. And that is why we have gathered here this morning to worship, to thank God for his invitation, and for the fact that we are no more a stranger or a guest, but we are like a child at home. We are glad that you are here today. Welcome home.
Will you pray with me? Father God, in his second letter to the Corinthians, Paul writes, "Brothers and sisters, rejoice, strive for full restoration, encourage one another, be of one mind, live in peace." Lord, in a world that's filled with division, especially among your church, let this be our prayer today. Let us seek full restoration with you and each other. Let us be encouraging to one another. Let us be of one mind with you, and let us live in peace. Lord, Paul tells us at the end of that verse that if we do that, you will be with us. May it be so today, Lord. Please be with us, teach us and love us, open our hearts and minds to what you have to say, and let us take that to the world. In your name we pray, amen.
Scripture tells us of an incident in Jesus' teaching. On this particular day, he's had lots of crowds around him, and he's been giving them instructions that were somewhat challenging. And a lot of people didn't like what he said, and a lot of people left. They just thought, no, this guy's not saying what I want to hear. I'm out of here. And so they turned and left. And Jesus, as the crowds were leaving, Jesus looked at his disciples and said, what about you guys? Are y'all going to leave too? And Peter spoke up and said, Lord, where would we go? You alone have the words of eternal life. I've been thinking about that verse some. I have been a follower of Christ for, 55 and 60 years now. But I've thought about how so many people now are call themselves nuns, and they refer to themselves as having really no religious affiliation. And I think, what would that be like? Honestly, I wouldn't know how to leave. I wouldn't know how to live a life without Christ. I wouldn't even know how to face the world or how to think about, how to perceive what the world is like without him. I don't say that to pat myself on the back. I say that to encourage you to think today, not to think about leaving, okay? But I want to encourage you to think about what a difference that Christ has made in your life. To think about where you might be if you didn't know him. About what your life would be like without God at the center of it. And as you think about that, that gives us a reason to be grateful. A reason to rejoice that God has worked his way into our hearts, that he has built our lives around him, that he has allowed us to come to know him, and he has shaped us and is continuing to shape us in his image. The songs that we're going to sing this morning, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine, and Knowing You, are both songs that express the blessings that we know because he is here within us. So as you're singing these songs, think about what a difference he has made in your life and how infinitely much your life is better because of him. And let's praise him as we stand and sing.
Oh, no. Thank you, Jackson. Thank you, guys. Thank you. We have a lot of sickness in our little ones, and so we need to pray for them that they would be, thank you, guys, that they would be better. And mom, and pray for our moms and dads as they're recovering. So I have a question for you guys today. Would you rather have $10,000 right now or a penny that doubles every day for the next month? A penny. See, this is the problem. Little kids don't know that that's a lot of money. Big kids might be able to figure it out.
I'll take $10,000.
Okay. Well, if you had a penny that doubled every day for the next month, it might seem like you're starting out kind of slow, because tomorrow, how many cents would you have? 2 cents, and then the next day, 4, and the next day, 8, and the next day, 16, and the next day, 32. Well, we're almost to the end of our first week, and it's not looking very good. We've only got like 32 cents, right? And Mark's got $10,000. But if we kept going, how much would you end up with at the end of the month? Anyone got a guess? 1,073,741,000. It's a lot of money. So when we start, over a billion dollars. That's a lot of money. So Pastor Mark, you've lost out on taking your 10,000, and everybody else has gained a lot for that. You know, that is something that's, there's two different kinds of growth, and that kind of growth is called exponential growth. It means it's doubling every single day. You know, Pastor Mark talks a lot about our five, right? Getting our five, but even if we just had one and we all brought our one within the next year, what would happen? We'd be doubled. How many people would be here if we were doubled? Yeah. And how about if you added a second person? Well, we wouldn't just be, and the new people brought a new person, and the new people brought a new person. And that's how growth works. That's why Pastor Mark talks so much about bringing our five, about praying for someone. So this week, pray for someone that you guys can invite. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that your growth is amazing. And Father, let us trust your plan and invite our friends and people that we know to come meet you here at this place. For we ask all things in thy son's name. Amen. Thank you, guys. At work today. So I know a lot of you guys are familiar with a good friend of ours from Ecuador named Mauricio, and Mauricio is working at a college in Ecuador, and he would like to bring between 4 to 6 students here this summer to run 2 weeks of a Spanish camp, and the Spanish camp will be free. He wants to run it for children between the ages of 6 and 11, 6 and 10, something like that. It's going to be something we're going to offer to the community. They are going to be in country for about 3 weeks. And we need a couple of things. But the first thing we need is some housing for these young people. They're college age people. Like I said, there's going to be somewhere between 4 to 6 of them. So, and the dates are not in cement yet, but they're close, July 12th through August 3rd. And so if you have extra space at your house and would be willing to host 1 or 2 young people at your house during that time, would you either call the office or let me know? Because we're trying to figure out if we need to put them up here at the church. They would prefer to stay in homes because they'll learn more about culture if they stay in homes. That's one of the things they're doing while they're here, is learning about what it's like to be in a different country and how it's different from where they live and stuff like that. So if you would be willing to host a college student from Ecuador for 3 weeks this summer, please let us know. The second way that you can help is obviously by praying. that we would be able to, this is a great opportunity for people during the summer to have a free week of camp. And so we're hoping it will be a good pull, but we need to get some kids here so that they have that experience and are able to have a full week of camp. And then the other thing is we're going to do a couple of things with them while they're here. Early on in their stay, we're just going to do a traditional summer cookout and kind of come and meet them and let them see some American culture. And then later on, we're going to invite them to make some of their native dishes. And we're also going to bring some of ours because, you know, sometimes we're willing to try, but maybe we won't like. And that way they can try some things that we like, and we can try some things that they like, and just kind of have a cultural exchange time. So if you would think about those events, and if you, we'd love for you to participate in them. We're really looking forward to them being here this summer and the opportunities that might arise from this. So if you'd be in prayer about the situation and the opportunity that we have to do ministry in this way in our community, I'd really appreciate it. Thanks.
Let's pray together. God, we thank you for the things that you have done in our lives. We thank you for the difference that you have made in us. Lord, I was thinking as I was listening to Eliza talk about this cultural exchange, and Lord, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to share our culture and to learn of the culture of Ecuador. But Lord, thank you for letting us know your culture. Thank you, Lord, for giving us a chance as we live in a world that with a very different culture from yours. Thank you, Lord, for giving us the chance to know who you are and to integrate your ways into our lives. Thank you for letting us get to know your culture and your kingdom. And Lord, thank you for giving us the responsibility to bring others into the culture, to bring others into the kingdom. Lord, help us to do that better. Help us, Lord, to, as we live in this world that is very different from yours, as we live in a kingdom of the world that is very different from the kingdom of heaven. Lord, help us to be good ambassadors of yours. Help us to shine your light. Help us to live in such a way that people will want what we have. Because, Lord, they're desperate for it. They are so thirsty for you without even realizing that that's what they're thirsty for. Lord, they're hungering for you without even realizing that you're the one that they're hungering for. They just know that they're hungry. They just know that they're thirsty. They know that there's something missing, and they're seeking so many ways to try to satisfy that hunger and that thirst, and nothing works. Lord, because nothing can satisfy the hunger and the thirst for you, except you. So Lord, help us to share your culture with the world around us. Help us to be the salt and the light that you've called us to be to the world around us. Lord, we don't need to beat them over the heads with the gospel. We don't need to argue with them. We just need to shine your light. We just need to share your love. Lord, help us to do that. Father, we pray for all of those who are sick. We pray for the grieving today. Lord, there is so much bad going on. God, we pray that you will change this world through us. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you know what you believe? I hope you do. If somebody asked you to describe what it is that you believe, what it is that makes you different, what would you know what to say? Can you summarize what you believe in a few sentences? Well, there's one way that the church has used for many, many centuries now. It's called the Apostles' Creed. Now, as Baptists, we don't generally do creeds. We believe that you can, at least Baptists have traditionally believed, in a big tent type of idea. That there are some things that you need to believe, but that we give people the freedom to interpret Scripture their own way. At least that's traditionally what Baptists have done. And so we've rejected creeds on their own, but that doesn't mean that creeds are bad. Creeds give us a chance to summarize, to understand, to put a handle on what it is that we believe. So I want to read with you today the Apostles' Creed. I would encourage you sometime over this week, look up the Apostles' Creed and just kind of read through it. Let that become part of your devotion for the next week, just to help you to understand what it is that we as Christians all over the world and all over the centuries believe. It says this: I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. What a great summary of what it is that we believe. The choir is going to sing about that now.
In this time of desperation.
Invite you to take your copy of God's Word and turn to Psalm 137. Today we begin a new series. Well, actually, we began it Wednesday night during the Ash Wednesday service. That will take us through Lent, and there are two thought processes behind this series. One is that it's for school, so you all get to learn with me, and so that's number one. But number two is that it seeks to speak to a point of ministry emphasis for us as a congregation. As we deal with food insecurity, as we deal with health care, as we deal with the plight of the incarcerated, you'll recall that we also deal with matters of environmental justice. And so this series will deal with matters of environmental justice and how to deal with those and address those in some way as believers. It is not comprehensive. If I could say that I could just all boil it down into six nice, complete sermons, I would be lying to you. In fact, my work is working on a plan for preaching on this subject for an entire year. And so you just get one part of it. But it is an urgent need that we must address. And so that is why we are focused. Psalm 137 says this: "By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. On the willows there we hung our lyres, for there our captors required of us songs and our tormentors mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its skill. Let my tongue stick to the roof of my mouth. If I do not remember you, if I do not set Jerusalem above my highest joy. Remember, O Lord, against the Edomites, the day of Jerusalem, how they said, lay it bare, down to its foundations. O daughter of Babylon, doomed to be destroyed. Blessed shall he be who repays you with what you have done to us. Blessed shall he be who takes your little ones and dashes them against the rock." Would you pray with me? Lord, we come to a text that is difficult. We come to a subject that is difficult. And Lord, in those twin difficulties, we recognize our supreme need for your grace in this moment, for the power of your Spirit to enable us to hear and to understand. And so, Lord, I pray that that would occur now. That, Lord, we could leave here better enabled to deal with one of the great crises of our time as believers, to extend grace and be the instruments of grace that you have called us to be. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our text this morning is a psalm in real time. It is experienced by one who has been forced from their home in Jerusalem after the conquering of the Babylonians and has been taken to this far and distant land of Babylon. And there they bitterly lament the loss of their home. But their home is beyond just a structure. Their home is all the other things that accompany home. It's the land, it's the smells, it's the sights, it's the feel of the dirt and the aroma of spring. It's a powerful psalm. And it opens up to us two powerful truths. One is the power of music in our lives, and particularly in how music can take us to places that we have been, but also take us to places that are far from us. In verse 3, he says, "For there our captives required of us songs, and our tormentors mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion." The songs of Zion, where they're in a foreign land and they were reminded of home, and they lament the fact that they are not home. Beloved, do you recognize the power of music to do that in your life? Do you recognize its power to take you to those other places in the distant past? You know, I think of two songs. One is inspired the title for the sermon today. It's "Carolina in My Mind," written by James Taylor in 1968, I believe it is, when he was far away from home and homesick. It is the unofficial anthem of our state, and more pointedly, for those of us who spent time on New Hope Chapel Hill, it is the soundtrack of 4 or maybe 5, maybe 6 years. I hear that song and I immediately go back to places that I encountered while I was a student at Chapel Hill. I immediately am carried to a distant place that grows more distant in time. And I can feel it all again once more. For me, another song in that line is by a group that you're probably not familiar with, called Smash Mouth. And they sing a song called "Walking on the Sun." That was from my time at Chapel Hill as well. And when I hear it come on the radio, I suddenly am transported. It happens every time I hear it. I am taken immediately to the lobby of Hinton James Dormitory. And I can smell the lobby, because it seemed like that was the song that was playing on G105 every time. And they had the same clip into it, it seemed like, every time. They would go Arbitron rated number one, G105, and then you go right smack into Smash Mouth. And suddenly I'm a sophomore at Carolina again. Music is powerful, beloved. It's why music is powerful in our faith, because it takes us to other places as well. Not just other places in our memory, but other places, period. Places that tells us new things about fresh expressions of life and invites us to experience them. I'm positive that these students who will be coming from Ecuador at some point will sing for us. They will sing the language and the songs of Ecuador, and they will invite us to participate. They will tell us of places we may have never experienced, and suddenly we will be able to go there. Music is powerful. That's why it is so central in our worship. But the other truth found in this text this morning is the power of place to bring us memories. To bring us memories of other places, yes, but above all, the power of place on us. Verse 1 says, "By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion." Can you imagine they're sitting there by the Euphrates, maybe, and suddenly their thoughts are cast back to not the Euphrates, but to the Jordan. Maybe to what they did on the Sea of Galilee. Maybe to the high mountains that existed around Jerusalem. It takes them back. And in doing so, it shows us that the places where we have lived, the places where we have been, are part of us. Beloved, no matter how hard I try, and I do try my best to make sure my accent gets where other people can understand it, and I might not eat some of the things that I used to eat, but no matter how hard I try, that rich black dirt of Eastern North Carolina is in my veins. The flatness of that land, though I love mountains, the flatness of that land, it just calls to me. It calls to me in such a way that Eliza will tell you that if I cross 95, my accent will change. If I talk to somebody on the other side of 95, my accent will change. Why? Because that place is part of me. It is who I am as an individual. And each of us have those places in our life where it is us. And we can't forget those places. Hence why verse 5 and 6 talk about, if I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget how to play the lyre. If I forget you, let my tongue stick to the roof of my mouth. I cannot forget the place. I cannot forget it. And it's why I have to pass it down to other generations after me. The theologian Melanie Harris Jones refers to this as eco-memory. We have to pass it down again and again and again and again. And talk about how the land was important to us, how it made us. If you talk and you get to know anybody for any length of time, you will hear about how the land where they lived or spent some important part of their life still comes up in conversation, and how they want it to be passed down. Lincoln City is a neighborhood on the banks of the Neuse River in Kinston. It was where formerly enslaved peoples built their homes after the Civil War. Lincoln City flooded multiple times, and as things progressed, it kept flooding. And after Hurricane Floyd, the city of Kinston and the federal government offered to go buy the land of Lincoln City, so that these people would not face flooding anymore. And so the people took the buyout. And they left this neighborhood, which had been a very prominent African-American neighborhood in Kinston. But the land still called to them. And so about 10 years ago, the people of Lincoln City started having reunions each year in a community center just adjacent to their old neighborhood. Beloved, before COVID struck, they were getting thousands of people every year who were connected to Lincoln City, flying in from all places around the country to go to that place for that weekend, because the land was important. The community and all that needed to be told. The stories needed to be told. That's what the psalmist is saying here. God forbid I ever should forget the land. God forbid I should ever forget where I came from. It is a part of me. And so when we reflect on these two truths, beloved, about the power of song, more importantly, about the power of place to evoke things in us, it raises for us some questions. It raises for us some questions like, what happens when people are forced from their land? That is what is occurring here in this text this morning. Not by this psalmist's choice were they removed from the land of Jerusalem? No, a conqueror came in and physically took them away, forced them away from their land, forced them away from what it was that God had given to him, because really that is part of their whole theological reflection in the land, because God gave them the land. It is the promised land. It was the place that they were brought out of slavery to go into. So the land is very much part of them. What happens when that land is taken away? Unfortunately, in our nation's history, this has occurred far too many times. It has occurred when early settlers imposed false notions of racial and cultural superiority on the first peoples of this land. It was imposed when enslaved peoples were wrenched from their homes in Africa to serve others' needs in faraway places. The story of Psalm 137 is a story that continues throughout history, and you say, but Mark, it's not happening today. But beloved, yes, it is. If nothing else, it continues very often for these last two groups that I mentioned, the indigenous peoples of this country and African Americans, who are being forced from the land that they have called home for hundreds of years because of the climate crisis we are in and humanity's oversized impact on the land. People like the indigenous peoples of Île de Jean Charles in Louisiana. Now, you and I probably never been to Île de Jean Charles. By the way, that's French for Jean Charles Island. I have to use that because I say I never used the French I learned at Carolina, so I had to say that. In 1957, that island in the bayou of Louisiana was 35 square miles. Today, it is less than 1 square mile. Now, to put that in comparison for you, it is as if Manhattan has been whittled down to half of Central Park. Now, think about how large Manhattan is, and think about in 60 years' time, it's become only half the size of Central Park. These people have been forced from their land. It is where this tribe of folks who were half Choctaw and half descendants of the Acadians, who, by the way, were forced from their land by the British, and they went and fled down to the bayous of Louisiana, have lived. And now they can't live there anymore because of changes in the climate. Changes in the climate which have caused over 30 some places that used to exist as bodies of water to no longer exist in South Louisiana because it's now just the Gulf of Mexico. Mark, that's just where it is. Well, beloved, it's over everywhere. It's the people of Princeville, North Carolina, on the banks of the Tar River, who lived there because that was the only land that was given to them after the Civil War, and with every bad storm now floods. It's the nation of Kiribati in the South Pacific, which will not exist by the end of this century due to changes in sea levels. Beloved, the phenomenon of people moving all around the globe because of loss of their own homes, loss of their land, loss of their place is a growing thing. And in 25 more years, those people will number over 250 million people. What will our response to those people be as Christians? Because that's really the big issue, right? How will we, as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ, respond to these people who no longer have a home all around the globe? But if you just want to narrow it down, how will we respond to them who live right here in this country and who will not have a home, will not have land that they have had forever? Will we be like the people in our text this morning in verse number 3 and taunt them? Oh, Mark, we won't taunt them. Yeah, we will. Yeah, we will. We'll say things like, well, if they lived somewhere else, they wouldn't have experienced this. Beloved, sad truth of the matter is that very often that was the only place they had to live. It was the only place they could afford. Or through unjust practices like redlining, it was the only place they could buy. Will we taunt them? Will we say, well, they can just pick up and move? Well, beloved, how easy would it be for you to just pick up and move? Well, I've got this and I've got that. Well, imagine if you don't have this or that. Do you know why we go to Kentucky? We go to Kentucky because they can't pick up and move. They're stuck. They have no jobs. Or the jobs they do have don't pay enough for them to break the cycles that they're in to get out. And by the way, beloved, you say, well, just sell your house. How can you sell a house, beloved, that's now underwater? We make jokes about that, right? I've got oceanfront property in Arizona. Some country singer made a gold mine off of saying that. It's just not available to them, beloved. So the question for us is, as children of God, as people of grace, as people who are called to love and serve one who came to love and to show what love is, whose very essence is love, will we seek to find equitable solutions for their repatriation and settlement? Will we make room for them? Will we make room for their sorrow and anger? Or will we be dismissive? The end of verse 8 says, blessed shall be he who repays you with what you have done to us. Blessed shall be he who takes your little ones and dashes them against the rock. Beloved, this is a hard text. This is an angry text. This is a horrible passage. And certainly, in no way, shape, form, or fashion, do we condone this thought. But at the same time, we must recognize within it a place of intense and raw emotion, of sorrow and anger, a place that a system of emotions that is going on that needs a place where they can be addressed. So the question for us is, will we make room for that? Will we allow that? Will we be empathetic to them? And will we provide for them safe places where they can be administered redemptive grace? Mark, they shouldn't think that way. Well, beloved, how often have you said, I'm so mad I could kill them? And if you say, never, I'll be in the back. You can point to some spot in your life where you've experienced that amount of raw anger. You can point to some point in your life where you have experienced that raw sorrow. And you can say, I needed a place. And very often you found that place here. And the question is, are we going to provide that place? Are we going to provide a place for them to sing the songs of their land? Are we going to be the place that provides them the balm of Gilead in redemptive grace, who says, as a people of hope, you right now are hopeless, but we will give you hope. Right now you are broken, but we serve a God who is the Prince of bringing whole broken places, because that's the definition of peace. We will provide that. Will we be on the front lines of that, beloved? Or we will be behind it. And sadly, the truth of the matter is that most of the time we will choose to be behind it, because we will not want to recognize the role that we played in it. Whether silently, such as in verse number 7. Remember, O Lord, against the Edomites, the day of Jerusalem, how they said, lay it bare, down to its foundations. The Edomites, beloved, as the children of Israel were trying to flee, to try to find safety, to try to find sanctuary, to try to flee from the yoke of the oppression that was the Babylonians, tried to run to Edom, and Edom called them and gave them into slavery back to the Babylonians. The Edomites, who were their brother, the Edomites, who were the descendants of Saul. So they are part of covenant thought. The Edomites said no. Did they take them into Babylon? No. Did they stand and cheer while it happened? Yes. Beloved, you and I can just be complicit by not saying a word. Or we could be very complicit. We could deal with it directly. Verse 8, O daughter of Babylon, doomed to be destroyed, blessed shall be he who repays you with what you have done to us. Beloved, I can't number for you. I can number for me the ways I have been directly responsible. But one way or another, complicitly or explicitly, we've played a role in this. If for nothing else, the fact that we have been silent has played a role in this. And so will we seek to change our habits? Will we seek to change our habits? Will we demand of our government entities to begin addressing urgent needs? Or will we be silent? What do you mean address? I learned something recently. Do you know that in some states in our union, you can have a house to flood, and when they can put the house together, and they, when you buy that house, when they want to sell that house, they don't have to tell you that that house is in a floodplain or floods regularly. It could be in a floodplain, you know it, but they address that. You say, Mark, that doesn't happen. It does. We also, our government from time to time will give kickbacks. Well, not kickbacks, but allowances for people to build in the floodplain. Mark, that doesn't happen either. Yeah, it does. Let me take you to Richlands, North Carolina, where they redrew the map. And people built houses down what on any other day is a thing that maybe you can get. If it's a real good shower, you can get your ankle wet in a place called Squire's Run. But after a hurricane, it floods everywhere. It floods everywhere to the point that my dad, after one recent hurricane, I called and I said, how are you doing? He said, fine. He said, I'm just sitting here watching them run jet skis down by Johnny Broughton's. Squire's Run. Our town allowed them to build there. That's not justice, beloved. That's not loving our neighbor. That's not being a people who believe that every life is precious, and that Christ died for all. And if we believe that, our beliefs, this I believe, we just heard the choir sing, demands our action, demands us to speak up for these folks, demands things to change. Oh, Mark, I'm just one person. Beloved, one person can change a whole mess of things. One person brought you from death to life. And you say, well, Mark, that was Jesus. Yeah, but somebody, one person had to tell you. So one person, beloved, can have an overabundance of influence. You say, Mark, I'm old. I'm fading away. I won't live to see how all this plays out. You know what, beloved? This occurs to me. I'm now 46 years old. I'll be 100 in 2078 if I make it. At this point, I'm just trying to make 2025. But do you know who will probably be around in 2078? Because she'll be a ripe old 63 about to retire. My scout. Don't I want the world to be a better place for her? Don't I want the world to be a better place for her? You say, Mark, I don't have any grandchildren. Fine. Pick one of ours that you see on Sunday morning. Don't you want it to be a better place for them? And beloved, hear me. Hear me. You say, Mark, what has all this got to do about the gospel? If the church does not begin to address these issues right now and show the world that we care about their plight, the church itself might not exist on this continent, at least, in 2078. The book of James says, what good is it if I tell a man to be well? If I talk to him about the issues of faith, but I don't meet his immediate need. That's a rough translation. This is the immediate need of the hour, beloved. This is the immediate need. We are called to this task. We are called to make the day where Psalm 137 is not sung by people who have lost their land. We are called to make right the wrongs that have generated Psalm 137 in someone else's life. We are called to it because this is the fulfillment of what Jesus told us was one of the greatest commandments. What is the greatest commandment? You shall love the Lord your God with all your being, and the second is like unto it, that you should love your neighbor as yourself. And so, beloved, this is loving our neighbor. Will we do it? Let's pray. Gracious God, this is a tough subject. It's a subject most of us haven't given any thought to. And Lord, I recognize all that. So maybe what it is that we're compelled to do is to learn more about it. And I pray that we would. But Lord, help us to see the urgent need of this hour and to respond as believers, as Christ followers. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Beloved, where has God spoken to you today? Wherever He's spoken, I'll be glad to pray with you. Maybe what God has spoken to you, though, is that, you know, He made all this for you to enjoy, and you realize that you don't know the one who made it. And you want to get to know Him. I'll be glad to show you that path. Maybe to say, you know what, this is an issue that I'm very concerned about. And I want to be a part of a group of people who are very concerned about it, and you'd like to be a part of Grove Park today. We'd love to have you. Whatever it is, though, don't miss God's call on you now. As we stand to sing, would you come? There's a lot of Baptists coming on Tuesday. You know they like to eat. So if you haven't signed up to make a dessert yet, please do so. If you haven't signed up to help clean up or set up, please do so. To that end, George Britton has the very detailed map that I drew of how to set up the gym, and would love to have your help in setting up the gym after service right now. So, beloved, as you go forth from this place, realize that you are go forth into a world that is crying out and in need of grace upon grace. And I pray you would go and show that. Would you pray with me the Grove Park prayer? Lord, by your Spirit.